Now back to the Pete McMurray Show. Here's Pete, Rob, and Lisa.
Listen to that guitar riff. I mean, come on now. Slash, featuring Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators, have a brand new album entitled Four. Let's welcome back to the show one of the greatest guitarists ever in the history of music. It is Slash. How are you, brother?
I'm actually really good.
Man, I was looking at your tour schedule. So you're on tour with Miles and the Conspirators now, and you have about 3 hours off, and then you go back on tour with Guns N' Roses. You're right. Always on the road.
Yeah, and then when the Guns tour is over, then I go back with the Conspirators, and that's next year. So we're touring all the way through from May with Guns from May through into next year, and then start with the Conspirators.
Jeez, man, do you find yourself sitting at home, laying in bed, and picking up the phone on your nightstand and trying to order room service when you're at home?
No, I've it's so funny because, you know, I've heard about that. I've heard some of my sort of rock star heroes when I was a kid talking about that. And then there comes the time when you just wake up and you think, I need coffee, and you just pick up your phone and you dial zero. And it does happen.
That's how you know you're a real rock star, friends. Right.
Who did you grow up? Because I grew up listening to you with Guns N' Roses. I love Jimmy Page. I mean, who was your guitarist guy? Was it Jimmy Page? Because you kind of have a little bit of that sound.
Yeah, well, no, Jimmy was a big one for me. I think originally when I first started, it was, Aerosmith was a big turn on for me. Mm-hmm. So it was Joe and Brad. And then AC/DC had just come out around that time as well. And I was totally into Malcolm Young and Angus Young. But yeah, Jimmy Page and Jeff Beck and Eric Clapton and Jimi Hendrix, these were the main guys that they were like the pinnacle of rock guitar,
right?
Rock blues guitar. So those guys were, you know, sort of like gods, you know.
The song on your new album, The River Rising, is such a signature Slash sound. I mean, you have such a unique sound. Do you always strive for that when you're writing music?
No, you just do what you do. But that's always like the coolest compliment that people can hear you. Well, you know, they say that they hear you and they know it's you. And that's like something that you can't plan, really. I mean, you can try and invent your own techniques and this and that and the other, but I mean, really, when you end up sounding like yourself is something that you don't necessarily have control over, you know, whether that's recognizable or not.
But that's awesome, because that means you're not like overthinking anything. I feel like so many times artists, we get like wrapped in our heads and you overthink like what questions you're going to ask, what music you're going to play, what you're going to wear, what, like, and you just get yourself in tied up in knots, and you just seem the opposite of that.
I'm conscious of not overthinking them, because it's easy to overthink. But I sort of shun that kind of, you know, that being part of your process is like to sit there and analyze stuff too much, because spontaneity is something that's the magic of it. And if you can nail it spontaneously, it's beautiful. So try and strive for that.
I'm glad you said that, because I'm a music and a sports guy, and I make it analogous to a 50 goal scorer trying to take a penalty shot. He starts to overthink what he's going to do as opposed to just doing it. At what point in your life did you know you're riffing on the guitar, you're doing your thing? At what point did you know, I can really do this, and I think this is going to be big? Did you have a seminal moment, or was it?
I haven't gotten there yet. I'm still working on it.
Fair enough.
No, it's true. Like, you know, I started doing it for the love of doing it. And I jumped in with both legs like right away and started in bands before I really had any business playing in front of anybody. And you just go for it, flying by the seat of your pants, and I'm still doing it that way. I mean, I've had some success, obviously, you know, with Guns N' Roses and all the different things but I mean, I just keep plugging away and plugging away, and it's still a work in progress, you know.
When did you start playing? How old were you when you first went on stage in front of a crowd and you're playing rock music?
The first gig I did was a gig at Al's Bar, which is a very adult 21 and over place in downtown Los Angeles. And my dad's friends had a covers band that was played like, you know, Stones and Creedence Clearwater and Muddy Waters and stuff like that. And, my dad took me down there and I jumped up and started playing with those guys. And I was, at the time, I think I was about 16. Or something. Oh, and that was like my first professional gig because they gave me beer afterwards. So I guess.
When did you start wearing the top hat? Did you wake up one day and say, you know, I need a thing. I'm going to wear a top hat at this gig. How did that start?
I always wore a hat. That was always for me. I always thought that was like the only way you could finish a look was to top it off with a hat. But I was Guns was playing at the Whiskey. It was 1985. And, we didn't have any money or anything like that. And I went down to Melrose, which is a pretty popular shopping area, cool shopping area in LA, used to be anyway. And I went down there and I went into the store, which was called Retail Slut at the time. And Tammy Downs from Faster Pussycat actually worked there.
Okay. All right.
And I saw the top hat. I thought, that's sort of cool. And I think I'd seen other people wear them over the years and always thought they were sort of cool. Anyway, so I picked up the top hat, I put it on and it looked cool. And then I walked out of the store with it. And then I went next door and there was a Leathers and Treasures, really cool vintage leather place. And I picked up a hat band, or actually it was a belt, but I cut it up and made it into a hat band. And I wore it that night at the Whiskey, and it just became a thing that I felt really comfortable in. Because I was always, you know, like all things considered, you, as a performer, you get out there and you jump around and this and that. But I'm not that outspoken a guy, and I get really shy in front of people. And so the hat, you could just pull it down, pull your hair over your face.
Right.
And you could just hide there. And no, it didn't matter what state of mind you were in. If you're having a bad hair day, you could just put the hat on.
I want to know if you've ever hid things in the hat, like extra picks, a pack of smokes, maybe a little bottle of something.
No. But I do have a hat box. Right. And I put a lot of it in that.
That I believe.
How many hats do you go on tour with? You have to have more than one.
Just one.
That's it.
Yeah, it's always been about just having one. I'm not like a big hat collector or anything like that. But I mean, I've been through a lot over the years. I've been many nights I've woken up somewhere and realized my hat was stolen, or I had one that I got stuck in the rain in London one time, and the next morning the hat was just melted. You know? Yeah, I'm not what you would call a real collector. Like, I don't have like a big shrine of hats.
That's so
not a
funny.
Hoarder like you, Pete. He can keep it simple. Right.
He can. We're talking with Slash. The new album is called Four with Miles Kennedy. By the way, I've seen you a few times at the Riv. I love Miles Kennedy. That guy's voice is just off the charts. I love him.
Yeah, he's great. I mean, that's why we've been together for so long. I mean, I didn't even realize it until we started working on this record that it's our fourth record, but we've been together for 10 years. You know, so I was like, wow, 10 years went by really quick. That's the longest I've been in any band.
Do you feel like the current music scene, that there are great guitarists that are young and coming up? Because it seems like we had so many great guitarists in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And now I just feel like everything is like synth pop.
Well, I mean, you know, there's amazing guitar players out there. And I'm very aware of it because, you know, like all the social networking platforms and stuff, people are posting stuff on YouTube and on Instagram and SoundCloud and whatnot. And there are like more guitar players out there than I ever realized. And I mean, I've been doing this for a long time, and it just seems like there's a lot of really amazing guitar players, and they all start at like 7 years old. They're incredible before they're 12. So that there's that going on. But I think that for a long time, you know, guitar goes in and out of vogue as far as pop music is concerned. Like one minute it's really a popular sound, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh no, guitar's dead, and it goes away for a minute. So in recorded, you know, in music, in rock and roll and pop music and all that, there's different phases where there's a lot of guitar, there's not a lot of guitar. Right now, it's one of those periods where in pop music, there's not a lot of guitar.
In your opinion,
there are a lot of guitar players out there.
You came up in an age where social media was just non-existent. Has that changed things?
For the best.
Right, exactly. Is it better or the worse?
It sort of goes with the times. I think social networking as it is right now, if we'd had that in the 70s and 80s, it would have been so over the top, you know, hedonistic to a point of just being almost illegal. But I think it's sort of evolved with things in a way that it makes sense at this point, you know.
Okay, I have a kind of a serious question. So we know a lot of professional musicians just from years and years of being by those giant speakers start losing their hearing. And exactly.
I'm sorry, what?
What do you I was like watching all these videos and listening to the new album and hearing your hands are so nimble. What do you fear more, arthritis or hearing loss at this point?
I'm interested. It would have to be arthritis because I have hearing loss as it is. So my ears are pretty damaged, but arthritis would be, and I'm constantly battling with that and anti-inflammatories so that you don't get pins and needles during the show because that makes it really hard to play. So there's, you know, you're conscious of all that stuff.
And when you're on stage, you're playing for 2 straight hours. It's like you're working out for 2 hours straight. What do you do before the show? Are you eating, not eating? Tell me about your pre-show ritual and when you get on stage.
I don't really do anything except for just play my guitar and just hang out until it's showtime.
That's it?
You know, He doesn't overthink it.
Yeah, I just go down to the gig and we do a sound check and you get all that together and then you just hang out, wait till it's showtime. Yeah, so
it's kind of like this show. We really don't do much of anything and then we got you on and we just talk.
Wait a second.
But I try not to eat too much because you don't want to be all weighted down before you play. So I just hang out in the dressing room playing my guitar and that's about it.
This is a true story. I did an interview with you backstage at the Riviera years ago. I think it was maybe one of your first shows with Miles. And we were in your dressing room and you were telling me that you had a Chicago guy at the time that was doing your dressing room. Do you remember that story?
Yeah, Sam.
Sam.
He's still working with us. Yeah.
Really?
He's a Chicago guy. See, I have a lot of history here, actually. I got family from here. My girlfriend, who I've been with since, I mean, well, on and off, but since 1989, I met here in Chicago. She's from Chicago.
Wow.
And my ex-wife before her was from Chicago. So,
oh, man, you got a type.
We just keep sucking you back in.
So yeah, I love the Midwest. You back in.
Is Slash coming to town and hanging out at Water Tower, going to the mall downtown?
No.
I'm not a mall guy. I
think I had a Slash sighting at the Lego store. Yeah.
That could definitely happen. I love Legos.
Slash's new album with Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators is called 4. Slash, hold on. We're going to talk more with Slash coming up.
Yeah.
Now back to Pete.
We're talking with Slash. His new album with Miles Kennedy and the Conspirators is called 4. Slash, you have 2 boys, right?
Yeah.
You have, I have a 16-year-old. You have one that's a year older, that's 17, and you have one that's probably 19 now?
19, yeah.
Okay, so you have 2 boys. When you go to high school and, you know, go to an event, a parent event, are all the dads grabbing you and saying, Slash, come on over here. Let's take a picture together. Or is it pretty cool?
It's for the most part, it's pretty cool. I don't hang around school too much. I didn't hang around school when I was in school. And I don't like to hang around school. I just don't feel comfortable around there. But, you know, I have my moments where I have to go in and be a dad and all that. And I did have, there were some birthday parties that I've been to and hung out with a couple dads who are in completely different industry than I am. And it's always a very sort of memorable conversations with people who are like in the doctor profession and you're standing around talking shop, you know? So it's interesting. The kids are a little older now, so I don't hang out around with other dads as much as I did when they were younger.
Are they into music? Anybody in a band?
My youngest is, he's more of an artist, like, you know, he like does amazing digital painting and stuff, but he does these incredible beats, you know, because he's a hip hop guy. So he does all these incredible beats and he writes piano music to it. And it's really, really good. But I don't think he has any designs on doing it professionally. Whereas my other son, London, the older one, is a drummer in a band called Saint Electric that's actually opening for Dirty Honey in San Diego.
Wow.
So, yeah, he's a really good drummer. So it's interesting for me. It's hard to even put into words just because I didn't have anything to do with him picking up the instrument directly. You know, he just all of a sudden started playing drums and he has a real natural aptitude for it. And it's just a trip for me to see that.
Have you guys played together on stage?
On stage, no, but I have jammed with him in the studio a couple times and he's opened up for Guns a couple times, or at least once.
So rad.
Yeah, in festivals.
Does he give you feedback then on like your new album? Is he like, well, you know, Dad?
He's very critical, you know, like he comes to shows. He was at a show in LA on this tour just a couple weeks ago. And he's like, oh, you guys are really, really good. And Brent's playing really great. You know, like I didn't know. He's like, and, you know, it's just that kind of thing. But it's cool because, you know, he calls me up. He goes, well, I'm driving out to San Diego for a gig. And can I have some gas money?
That's so perfect. On the new album, is there a solo that you love the most? Because we all think of you as like such a great guitar soloist. Is there one that just like you get into it every time?
Not really. It's because you know what it is that you're so attached to the record. It just came out and you're really close to it, and you don't really differentiate one being better than another because they all have their own meaning. The whole record was live, so it's a lot of improv on it, so that awesome. Solo was very, very fluid for a one-off. You know, so I thought that was pretty cool.
I wanted to ask you about that. How come more bands, and Lisa's a musician and she's talked about this, more bands don't do it live because, you know, somebody's on one coast and another person's on another coast and you're wearing headphones.
There's some magic when you're all in the same room. It's a different magic.
This is what's wrong with the whole, I mean, I don't want to say the industry because, you know, a lot of stuff is fabricated and doesn't matter. It works great that way. Katy Perry doesn't need to be in the same place.
As her drummer, no.
Right? And it works. But for rock and roll, it is primarily organic music to begin with. It's an ensemble. It's like rock and roll, blues, classical, and jazz all need to be played together. It's part of that. That music lends itself to the people.
Right. You feed off their energy.
But what happened is we got to a point of just getting lazy. And then you have all this amazing technology that makes it so you can make a record and not know how to play a note. And producers, who I got to give a lot of credit to, because they make records happen and they do all the heavy lifting for bands that are very, very popular that don't know how to play a song from one end to the other.
So depressing.
But yeah, so, you know, what happens is everybody's phoning it in. But I also have realized that young kids now, this next generation of musicians, have picked up on that and then gone back and discovered how it was done when it was just like you only have two takes to record a single and that's it. And everybody had to play together and you actually had to know what you're doing. And kids are picking up on that and just learning how to really learn how to play and do rock and roll pop, you know, properly. So it's exciting to see what's going to be happening over the next 5 years. But yeah, just getting into a room together and playing the song and learning the material is something that has become a little bit sort of blasé at this point, but it's really taking the life out of the music.
Think about all the old bands like Led Zeppelin and Aerosmith and Springsteen. They're always in the same room together.
Yeah. And that's how it works. That's where the magic comes from. Mm-hmm. And so when we did this, like I've always, ever since we started, always strived to do everything live, but I always had a problem with headphones. So I would do a scratch track with the rest of the band for the energy. And then I would go into the control room and play in front of the monitors really loud. Right. But I always said, why can't we just play in the room with the amps like the Faces did back in 1972?
Right.
Oh, well, we just, you know, there's bleed and producers just want to be in control of all the sounds so that they can manipulate them however they want. But we didn't have those luxuries back then, right? So all these years, I've always wanted to do it where you just have the back line on the floor the way you would in a club and just mic everything up and go for it. And Dave Cobb allowed us to do that. So it was really liberating to go in and, you know, get up, go down, learn the song, and we get the arrangement together, play it a few times, learn it, and then record it live. And everybody had to be on so that you didn't have to record it yet again, right? I mean, that's a great way to do it.
Describe that. Like, seriously, it just sounded so sexy to me. I'm like, real people in a room together.
Yeah. It's like eye contact. It's actually a lot like sex.
There's a give and a take, and people are in the same. Like, if somebody pre-recorded half of the song, you can't change the tempo. You can't push anything forward or pull it back.
No,
if you're all together, you could manipulate it in real time to make magic.
You can make mistakes actually sound like they were on purpose just by looking at the other guy and going, all right, you know, and you sort
we'll
of
keep it.
Yeah. But I mean, you're playing off of each other, so somebody can change what they're doing in an instant because they see what's about to happen, and so they can sort of make something up that goes along with it. And it's just it's a lot of stuff going on. The thing is that when you listen to records like that, people don't know why it sounds like that or why it has that energy. It just does. And right. That's now that a lot of records, most records don't have that. They don't know what's missing. They're like, oh, this is okay. But something's missing. I don't know what it is. It's usually that sort of spontaneous thing that's missing. So
yeah, I just want to be known by one name, man. Rob. That's it. Yeah. Slash Rob appearing tonight. It's all good.
And it's so much easier to spell, you know, when you're handwriting to sign, you know.
Slash, it's great to talk to you. I love you, man. I love that you continue to come on the show, and you and Miles Kennedy are magic together. You know, I love GNR and I love you, and I'm so happy for you with this new album.
Thank you. And we're having a blast, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, brother. Slash, everybody. How about a big round of applause for Slash?
Yeah.
Man.
Woo!
Yes.
Slash. All right.
Thanks, man. We'll see you soon.
All right. Take care.
See ya.
More of the Pete McMurray Show next.